Okay, welcome back, everyone. We will continue. We were talking about encouraging partnerships and if leaders can encourage partnerships in whatever is already going on in the city. Plus, there can be some new things that can be started. You know, it'll be a great blessing to the city. So, how can we have partnerships and things that are already going on? Maybe there are programs where the poor are being ministered to. There's some feeding program for the poor, or there can be some kind of an education program that's going on for slum children. There could be, you know, some such activity that's already going on. The leaders can encourage their congregations, maybe individuals in their congregation, or there can be some ministries that are involved in this area. They can look at how they can sort of, if you can use the word cross-pollinate, bring in expertise, whatever each one has, to make that stronger, okay, to make that program more effective. Pastors and leaders can work towards partnerships that will strengthen the initiatives that are already existing. So one of the things that I can talk about is this is not in the context of citywide, you know, citywide church, but you know, we have these Christian mission hospitals across India, and from time to time, you know, we keep seeing how we can strengthen them in whatever it is that they need. Now, over the years, several activities have been done. Several years back, you know, there was some initiative where we had our team go and strengthen. Okay. Sorry about church. It just sorry, my chair just keeps going down. Yeah, we had an initiative where we went and, you know, we found out, okay, they needed help in certain areas. I don't know all the areas that they were helped in, but you know, one area was they wanted their space to be made better. So a team of young people had gone from our church and they had painted, you know, that mission hospital. They had done some creative painting over there, and it was such a blessing. And also, because we're a church, we can equip spiritually. There was a short-term Bible college which was run in the campus of the hospital, because several, you know, the Christians who were living close by, they did not have these resources and such opportunities. So people from APC Bangalore were sent to teach, you know, week after week, and believers from across that region could gather in the hospital, and the hospital had given permission to do this, so we could engage in spiritual equipping, right? There are other times where I know when people have needed, you know, some sort of help in technology, or they have needed some help in managing the human resources. We are trying to extend support because there's something that they are very good at. Recently, during the COVID relief, we had one category for community hospitals. So there were quite a few mission hospitals that had applied, and the COVID relief report is still on our website. You can go and look it up. They were granted, you know, certain amounts of money to buy equipment to help them during this pandemic season. So, you know, there is something that an organization is good at and they are doing it really well, but they might need help in other areas. They might not have finances. They might not have, you know, expertise of some sort, maybe administrative capacity or, you know, spiritual capacity. Now, other organizations which are good at these things, they can step in and they can say, hey, what is being done? Let's say a feeding program for the poor. It's a good thing that we're doing for the city. How about, you know, we all pitch in and make this more effective, make this stronger. So when the body of Christ in a city comes together and you know, they serve together, we can have a better impact. So whatever programs are going on right now, the leaders, the pastors can look at a way to collaborate and strengthen them. Maybe there are some, you know, Christian organizations which focus on special things, okay? And some churches are also strong in that area. For example, Christian marriages. Christian marriages. Yeah, thank you, Kennedy, for that question. I'll come to that point soon. Christian marriages. Maybe there are some Christian organizations that do seminars, okay, on strengthening Christian marriages. And then there are a couple of churches also which are good at this particular subject. Now, these two can collaborate, right? They can collaborate and they can offer a program which maybe the other churches would be open to, and go strengthen other churches in this very area. So things like that, these kind of things can be done for collaboration's sake, and it will be a blessing to the body of Christ. Please excuse me, class. I'll just sort this chair. Yeah, sorry for wasting your time on this, but okay. So collaboration of this kind would really help. Now, if it's not about expertise, if it's not about action in a particular area, maybe there are churches that are, you can use the word rich, okay, or they have money, they have resources. They can look at churches that are struggling. Like, for example, now, COVID season, we know that so many churches have struggled. People have left the churches. There's not been enough money to take care of the pastors' families, right? So all these things have happened. The churches that do have the capacity, they can just go ahead and maybe give an offering to the churches that don't have. Or let's there are quite a few churches that want to build. They want to construct their even a basic facility, a hall where they can meet and they can worship, but they don't have the money. Okay, in North India, a lot of pastors meet in homes, but it's not allowed. Right? In some regions, it's not allowed to meet in homes. They can get into trouble for having gatherings in a home setting, and they really need a hall, but nobody is willing to rent out their hall. So there are pastors who are struggling for, they're struggling for a structure, a building. So the ones that are richer, we can extend help to those who don't have. Now, this can happen even within a city. Just look, just ask, just find out what the needs are. Now, after COVID, maybe churches are struggling to restart. They can't pay the rent anymore because they've not had an income for 2 years. So maybe we can help in that area. So financially, giving financially can help strengthen the churches in their physical needs. It can help, them spiritually. Maybe they need some resources to run their Sunday services. They can buy that. So if we are not collaborating for the sake of a cause, offering our expertise, we can at least offer financial help to churches. And that also will strengthen the work which is going on in a city. We could spiritually equip, other churches in the city. And this can be through, sermons, publications, podcasts, whatever, anything that God has given us, we can bless others with that. So these are all ways of strengthening the work of God that's already going on. People are already engaged in different things. We want to make it better. We want to make it effective. And similarly, we could look at starting some new initiatives. So new initiatives, meaning there could be a new problem that arises in a city, and believers, leaders can look at a new way of addressing that matter, bring in people who have the skills to work on that, and have a vision, a goal, set a mission, and then go ahead and start working in that area. So these are all things that we can engage in. Now, what are some of the challenges? Now, when it comes to churches collaborating on existing programs, we have to make it very clear. The boundaries have to be established. Because the fear that a lot of pastors might have is, okay, yeah, we are running this program, but we are running it like this. This is our vision. What if somebody comes and they dilute what we are doing? So if there are clear boundaries that are set, that can be discussed, right? That can be agreed upon, and maybe even put that down in writing. It always helps to put it down in writing. Maybe send an email and say, hey, okay, we had this discussion. We've agreed that this is what we are going to do. You are going to share this content, and we are going to share this content. And if there is some kind of a financial thing agreed on, then put that down also, because later on we don't want to get into trouble, right? And it sars relationships. So these are the challenges that pastors are always afraid of, that relationship will get spoiled, or the project that they've been running in a certain way, that will get diluted. But as long as we discuss and we are clear on our agreement, and also when pastors have a kingdom mindset, these things can be resolved, and also we can work together. Now, if anything new is being started, then that also is difficult, because let's say five churches, they've come together, and there is a flood in a certain place, and they want to do something about it. They want to provide money, they want to provide food material for the people who've been affected by the flood. Now, since this is a new project, administratively, how are the churches going to work together? That has to be very clearly defined. Otherwise, there will be confusion. So, who, like, what is the vision? What is the mission? How long will the project run? Who is responsible for handling the finances? Who are the candidates that we are going to help? What is the criteria to select those candidates? How will the money be sent to them? So, discuss all these things administratively. Who will transfer the money? So when we have the administrative side very, very clear, we can avoid a lot of confusion when there are new initiatives that are started. So that is something that we must bear in mind. I'll just come to the questions here. So Kennedy is asking, how do they consolidate their funding when handling this parachurch activity between APC and other churches? Okay. So Kennedy, are you asking about any project which we have run?
Do they have a financial kitty? Do they have funds to run those programs jointly?
Yeah, so depending on the program, there is an arrangement. There's always an arrangement, Kennedy. Okay. And it varies from program to program. I can talk about the COVID relief program, which happened recently, which was a collaboration of churches, actually. But in this program, what we had decided was that APC will run the program, meaning the process of the program will be completely, it will be the way APC decides. Okay, so we had it planned. We had our IT team set up the portal. We had a team who were making the verification call. So the process was completely our decision. And in terms of money, what we said was, we said that we set up this COVID relief fund, and we invited churches to give in the money. Okay, so there was no specific amount which was asked of them. Whatever they were willing, they could send. So some of the churches sent in the money that they could. And yeah, APC put in the money that they wanted to. And that whole fund, that entire fund, right, that was used to meet the needs of the people. But here's the other thing, transparency. How much money is coming in? How much money was received for the program? It was on the website, like real time. So that provides confidence for everyone who's involved. Okay, this much money is required. This much money is available. So much money, or you get what I'm saying, right? So the availability of funds and the use of funds is out there for everyone to see. And then we had the accounting as well. So from the accounting side, everything was accounted for. Even right now, it's on the website, you know, how the money has been used, how much money came in, how much money was sent to the people. And if anyone wants to see the accounting part of it, they can always email us and ask us, and it will be, you know, it is available for people to go through. So that is the kind of transparency that was maintained. So does that help, Kennedy?
Yeah, thank you. Because last time, I heard from pastors that they had some surplus. They even donated to other churches in your locality. Yeah, and that was very inspiring.
When was this?
He did mention, I think during this COVID period, they did raise some. They had
Oh.
some surplus, and they
Yeah.
even it really touched me, and like it was so
Yes,
encouraging. Especially
yes, yes.
this discuss financial things.
Correct, correct. Yeah,
Yeah.
thank you, Kennedy. That is separate from COVID relief. That was at the beginning of the year. I think 15 lakhs of amount was given to local churches to restart their churches because we had a surplus. So after discussion with the board and all, an amount of money was set aside and it was given away. So that's different. Yeah, correct. Okay, so I think we have addressed Kennedy's question sufficiently. Coming to Sri Kumar, Global Leadership Summit. Yeah, Bill Hybels can be considered one of this. Okay, yeah, yes, sir, Sri Kumar. That's a collaboration, isn't it? You want to shed more light on it?
I just want to know that whether it is, it can be considered or not, that's why.
Yeah, it can be considered, and they are primarily making an impact on the marketplace.
Yes, that's why.
Yeah, leadership principles and, you know, work-related
Yeah, that's true.
things.
Thank you,
Yeah,
Pastor.
yes, yeah, thank you. So that's also a partnership. Okay, right. Yeah, let's continue. So we've looked at collaboration and impacting the city. It can be done through new initiatives or it can be done through old initiatives. But the key thing is to maintain those boundaries and have the you know, understanding between the churches. Okay, so as long as that is in place, I think we don't have to worry about pastors fighting with each other and all that. Okay, now moving on to citywide unity gatherings. Okay, there's a scripture in this section from Psalm 50, verse 5. It says, "Gather my saints together to me, those who have made a covenant with me by sacrifice." So, gathering of God's people in a city, that can be very powerful. That can be really powerful. There are some examples of cities where something like this was practiced and they saw a mighty breakthrough. You know, generally, I go back to this what do you call the transformations testimony that came in from places like Cali in Colombia, where there was a lot of crime, drug trafficking, murder. But the citywide church decided to come together for prayer meetings. And when they started these prayer meetings, you know, eventually they saw a change in the crime rate. Like the crime rate fell, and you know, there are actually articles that you can go read up on what happened after the these citywide unity gatherings took place. So churches from the city, they came, they had sessions where overnight, you know, they had prayer and, you know, they had fasting times together and worship times together and all of that. So God can touch the city, you know, as Second Chronicles 7:14 says, that if we seek God, if we turn from our wicked ways, right, we humble ourselves before God, then God can do mighty things in the city. So when churches come together, yes, God can move, but it's also a picture of our unity. It's a sign of us being together. And it's good to have such programs in a city. These are unity gatherings. Okay, unity gatherings. So, what can be some of the challenges? Unity gatherings are definitely, you know, needless to say that they are wonderful. But what can be some of the challenges? Some of the challenges can be that, you know, pastors may feel insecure. They may feel that, okay, you know, my church, we are doing really well. But then there are these other churches who have better technology and, you know, better feel of their services. What if my congregation comes to know about those services? And once they know that there are better ways of doing church, what if they leave me and they go join the other church? So the insecurities that pastors have, you know, that can be an issue. Whenever we talk about city, you know, unity gatherings in the city, one of the things that the leadership can do is they can discuss among themselves and they can say that, okay, you know, we will speak to our congregation. We'll tell them, look, this is about us getting together as brothers and sisters in the city for the blessing of the city and, you know, to kind of bless one another. And even the pastors can discourage if, you know, people are coming from other churches. So you could say something like, you know, please remain faithful to your own congregation or something like that. So then if that is sorted, then I think the pastors will be a little more comfortable to have meetings like this where people gather together. Then pastors also might be concerned that whatever they've taught their people, you know, what if something erroneous that's going on in another church that affects my people, right? So you know, these citywide gatherings are for a limited period of time, and the program which is planned, it's focused on the common faith that we have, right? Because when we see Ephesians 4, it says that God has given the fivefold ministry offices for the equipping of saints, right? For the maturing of saints. And then we see that God wants to bring us to the unity of the faith. Okay, so that is the reason the church is being equipped. So the unity of the faith can still exist among people of different denominations and you know, different you know, types of worship in the Christendom, because as I told earlier, what we believe about salvation, what we believe about God remains the same, right? And in these gatherings, the format can be such that we are focused on the unity of the faith, okay? And we don't bring up any other matters, and we just keep it at that level. So people come together, worship together, pray together for the blessing of the city, and that's about it. You know, they go back. So where is the question of indoctrinating the other congregation with something different? And some of the practices that can be followed in these unity gatherings is that simple format, you know, and style where we keep it limited to praying for the city, okay, and blessing one another. We can also think of having communion, okay, introducing communion into the unity gatherings. Because what is communion? You know, communion is being at the table of the Lord. And as the body of Christ, when we all partake of the communion together, you can imagine, you know, how powerful. Proclamation of the victory of the be taken up in these unity gatherings. Also, we must bear in mind that people are coming from different, depending on the city. Like if you take up Bangalore, you know, people here speak a couple of languages, some common languages are there. So if you just conduct the unity gathering in English, everyone may not be able to participate. So if there's a unity gathering, then it would need to be you know, English, maybe translated to Kannada and maybe translated to Tamil also, because there are a lot of people who speak Tamil. So things like that. We'll have to plan the format in such a way that it edifies the body of Christ. And also other things. Now, if we only sing the latest songs everybody may not be edified by that. So maybe we can have some Kannada songs, we can have some Hindi songs, we can have some, you know, hymns, old English hymns. So we have to make sure that the gathering of the citywide, you know, that body is edified in that program. So we plan the format in that kind of a way. And also, it would be good if we keep it as a unity gathering, okay, and only Christ is exalted. So, which means that, you know, there will be a lot of Christian leaders in our city whom we want to honor. And definitely, you know, they would have done a sacrificial work and they would be stalwarts in our city. And yet, you know, if we don't elevate any of the leaders, I think it will be better, because it will be true to its call of being a unity gathering. So those format can be kept very simple, just worship, prayer, intercession, blessing over the city, sharing, the breaking of bread, right? And that's about it. So no pastor, no minister, nobody to be elevated. So that way, you know, it'll not be about focusing on any human being, but it'll be about focusing on Christ. So this is something recommended for a unity gathering in a city. Yeah. And then the next section here is about the entire citywide church working on impacting all the areas of the city. So before we go into that, any other thoughts about these unity gatherings? Do any of your cities already have it? You could please share, and then we can touch on the next point. And I, as I told you in the last class, we've had this in Bangalore. At least I have witnessed it. Lately, I haven't seen any. Maybe because of the COVID season, but yeah, we've had such events here in Bangalore. Yeah, if you would like to share from your country or your city. Okay, I'm just going to Kennedy's question here. He says, how do you celebrate your success stories at APC? Okay, Kennedy, can you just expand on that? I didn't quite get your question.
It seems you are doing a good job there, but just as a matter of motivation and encouragement to others, how do you celebrate, or how do you share your story of success with others?
Okay.
Now that you have five of them, eh? New Archbishop Churches.
Now that
you have five affiliate churches, like more, you have your other parent churches, the smaller churches.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Good question, Kennedy. Thank you. It happens formally and informally. Formally would be that it is communicated during the Sunday service before the service starts. You know, that small segment where you can make some announcements. It's communicated then. Or informally is, you know, most of us here, we have these WhatsApp groups. Every location has its WhatsApp group. Every team has its WhatsApp group. So then information gets circulated in that way, in an informal way. Another good way of celebrating any success story or testimonies is, you know, now that technology is possible, you can have a page. So for COVID relief, that's what we did. We had a page of testimonies. So when testimonies came in, it was added to that page, and anyone could go read it, and it would strengthen them to see what God was doing in people's lives. So just some ways. Yeah, is that okay, Kennedy? Okay, great, sure. Yes, okay, so Samuel says, there was one in Sikkim recently where all churches came together to meet the new CM of Sikkim. Okay, very nice. The old CM was in office for 25 years, but it became a disaster. Oh, okay. Yeah, Samuel, I don't know if I can ask you for details, because this is being recorded. Yeah, but Yeah, you want to say something? We can't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Now we can hear you.
So I wasn't present, but all the reports that I heard was mostly there was almost a contest for the airtime. So different leaders had to come and give a small speech. I don't know what the purpose of that speech was, but different church leaders were given some airtime. But unfortunately, most of them ran, like if they were supposed to speak for 5, 10 minutes each, they ended up speaking 20, 25 minutes each. And it was mostly about reports of how, what and all the churches had done. So they were kind of, I think it almost became like a contest of which church had done more work in Sikkim. So I was wondering what the CM must have walked away with from that meeting. And he sat, he listened to everything, and then his was a vote of thanks. He gave the vote of thanks, and he went away. But I unfortunately can't say, like, you know, what his impression might have been. I mean, they didn't fight openly, but it was more like, you know, my church did this, my church did that. So everyone kind of came along.
So yeah, that's unfortunate. You know, and that's why we're saying that as far as possible, if in the format we keep it about, you know, just worshiping the Lord. And not necessarily, you know, give churches or leaders an opportunity to share something about themselves or about their ministry. That would be great, because then there's limited time, right? And it's so difficult to organize a unity gathering. I remember one unity gathering which happened maybe 10 years back, and people had come from different churches, and it was organized in a ground, and it was just so huge, and to be able to pass on the communion elements was such a task. Okay, so as it is, organizing these meetings will be a very, very difficult thing. So the simpler we keep the program, the better. People are coming, they're spending their time, they're spending their energy, resources to be there for that, whatever, 1 hour or 2 hours. Just imagine, you know, depending on the size of the city, or the body of Christ in that city, we're talking about parking for those many people, paying for the venue, you know, having ushers, putting out chairs, and making all the preparations. So, keeping in mind that everyone is expending their energy, we want to really value that effort and keep it very focused, so that, you know, nobody's disappointed. People are coming to worship the Lord, to pray for the city, to bless one another, and we, you know, do our best to keep the format that way, and that will be a incredible blessing. Okay, so yeah, thank you for sharing. Samuel, anyone else just want to add to the conversation here? Yeah, so for an event like this, again, finances is a big deal. It must be planned. In a wise way, okay. So every church has to be clear on the amount of money that they are putting into it, and then the collaboration, right, of the churches. Like, they all have to know how it's going to be used. And another thing is, there must be a clear report on how the money was used, right? That transparency is required. Whenever any partnership or collaborative work is done, it is good to be absolutely transparent about the funds that are being utilized, and to give a report on how they were utilized. Okay, so that accounting has to be maintained. And that will also add to the prolonged unity and collaboration of churches. But if that area is neglected, you know, there can be a lot of issues if the finances are not handled properly in these collaborative efforts. So we can just bear these things in mind if ever or whenever we are a part of programs like this, we can just help in organizing them in a proper way so that it really serves its purpose. Now let's move on. The next section here is about the citywide church serving the city. Okay, serving the city. So now, as we've said, every local congregation brings its own impact because God has called each one of us with a certain vision. Now, if all the churches work together, we can see transformation spiritually, socially, in the marketplace, and also in the physical areas. So spiritual transformation, what does that mean? No, it is collaboration. It is collaboration for spiritual growth. So for us to see that spiritual transformation, how can churches and believers collaborate? Now, I have heard of prayer groups. Okay, prayer groups. In fact, one of the very very famous and close to my home, there's a tech park. And in that tech park, you know, I've had friends from other churches, and I also know of people from my own congregation. Now, these people, they have booked a time in their boardroom or whatever space they have for meeting. They have booked a time something like once a week, and people are from different churches, and they've taken permission also to just come together to spend time in prayer. Okay, they pray for their company. They pray for their tech park. They pray for the surroundings. So things like that. Are these people from various churches? Yes, they're not from the same church, but they're bringing a blessing to the city because they're united in their cause and in their purpose. And again, you know, I know some of my friends are part of these Bible studies, and it's a pleasant thing. So far, I've never heard them complaining that, oh, so-and-so is from that church, and, you know, these people are from another church, and this doctrine, that doctrine. No, it's very simple. They gather together, they pray together, they pray for one another, they share a simple word, encourage each other, and that's about it. But you know, these small groups are a blessing to the city. So spiritual transformation, we can come together despite us being in different local congregations. We can pray, we can bless one another. We can also have, you know, local churches and ministries working together. We already said, you know, when it comes to spiritual aspects that we are blessed with, we can share that. Maybe certain teachings that we have, we can share with somebody else, or there can be some efforts with regard to evangelism. So churches can collaborate. I told us about that Path to Change event. Things like that. Things to do with evangelism, things to do with discipleship. People can collaborate and serve the church. So spiritually, serve the city. Spiritually, the city is blessed. There can also be, times of spiritual warfare. That makes up a huge part of when it comes to impacting the city. So gathering as pastors, gathering as leaders, gathering as various congregations in the city, when we come, when we pray regularly, for the long term, you know, we pray for the city. These kind of things will make a huge impact on the city. So wherever, in cities where you have things like this happening, it will be a blessing. Now, that is the spiritual aspect. How can the body of Christ bring about social transformation? You know, whatever we talked about earlier, we can understand the current situation of our city, and there might be issues that we want to pick up. Your poverty, your education, corruption, oppression, things like that. So we pick it up, and then we see, okay, who has the expertise? What is the arrangement between, you know, these ministries? put it down in writing, and then go ahead in a clear way, go ahead and contribute whatever you have to contribute. So in that sense, when people join hands, we are able to do more for the society. Marketplace, okay, marketplace. Again, I think recent few years back, there was this program called as Lead Talks, where they invite people from various walks of life, and just to inspire people for the marketplace. Okay, and the speakers are from many churches, many different churches, but they are trying to make an impact on the marketplace. Now, I thought that was a good example of a collaborative effort of, you know, people of God coming together to speak about the principles from God's word, and examples, you know, real life examples of people who followed those principles and who have done well in the workplace, right? Politics, there were people who spoke from the area of politics and business and education and so many fields, and that made an impact. Now, that's an example, but, you know, the seven mountains, there are the seven mountains which influence society: arts and entertainment, media, business, education, government, family, religion. If we can have godly people making an impact on all these mountains, that will make an impact on the city at large. So individuals, ministries, congregations can try to collaborate in some way to make an impact. Now, apart from that, physical transformation. Okay, physical transformation has to do with the city. Maybe there are issues with the infrastructure, right, of the city. A particular city, it's possible that they have a settlement where there are a lot of poor people. Now, how to address that? The churches may want to get together and approach the civic authorities and see for some changes in the policy that can be made, or they can contribute, they can offer their support in some way, let's say financially. They want to give some kind of money for the building of homes, or they want to offer help, right? Like, we will build those homes. Something like that. So physically also, there are many aspects in a city that the church can work towards. What about health and hygiene? You know, that is something. Or transportation, water, different things that you pick up as important for that city, you could help with. So that's an area where the church can make an impact. Again, I'm just leaving it open. If you have examples from your city, then you could please share that. And before that, Kennedy has a question. He says, please talk about the church and the state partnership. Church and the state partnership. So I think what I said now applies to that, no, Kennedy? That we approach the civic authorities and we offer whatever we can. So if that is prayer, or if that is finances, or like physical help, then we can collaborate in that manner.
What about asking on things like legislation?
Legislation.
Because I was made to understand that in a place like India, having or receiving that is an offense. Or there are places where you see things like homosexuality have been legalized and they have been made law. So what's your take on that?
Yeah, so you see, as normal citizens, we have a voice, okay? If you're specifically asking about the voice of the church, I think yes, the church does have a voice. Okay, now recently, in fact, I'm going to that next section here, which is a united response to persecution. In times of persecution, we have seen churches have written to authorities, the local authorities, and you know, they've said that we are not doing anything that is against the constitution, and so we want your support, right? So the church does has a voice, Kennedy, and yeah, we write to our authorities, we go by the constitution, and whatever it is that we can propose, we do that to rise up against maybe a wrong policy that might come in place. So that's how it works here in India. Is there any other person who wants to add to what I just said, so Kennedy understands the Indian system better? Like recently, Kennedy, there was one incident of, not one incident, many incidents of opposition in churches. Like while the services were going on, people of a particular mindset, like they went and they disrupted the churches. And when that happened, I think the Catholic Church in that place, I don't know exactly which church, but one of the large churches, like they initiated and they wrote out this letter to the authorities. And then the other churches joined together. The other churches joined together and they all declared a day of rally. So all the churches together, they walked from one point to another to go meet the authorities there, to give them a letter, like in a peaceful way, to give them a letter and just to request for protection because they were not doing anything that was against the constitution. So yeah, in this way, we kind of respond to situations.
What about the things like anti-conversion laws? You know, they're very strange to us. We never heard of things like anti-conversion laws. And I think Brother Prabhakar the other time had an issue on it. I don't know if it was in this session. One of the Prabhakars, the one RO, if you are an anti-conversion law.
Yes, yes, yes. So this is all, it's a little tricky, Candy, and for me to answer here. But I can tell you this much, that it's not like the Christian voices are quiet. You know, on the other side, we have people in the legal system. We have those who are very well aware of the constitution. We have bodies like, okay, I'll share a name. There is a group called the ADF. Okay, you can look it up, ADF International, which is actively involved in addressing matters of persecution. And they are also at a level where they can appeal, right? They can appeal for certain laws not to be passed. And so they're rallying for I mean, you can just look it up. They're doing a good work and they're doing it at a very high level. So ADF International is a good organization. There are...
Is it the Alliance for Defense?
Alliance Defense of Faith, right?
Yeah,
correct. So they are very active. They're very active. They are helpful in educating the grassroots level pastors on their rights. And also educating them on the wrong practices. You know, sometimes pastors get into trouble because of doing things the wrong way. So the government is not to blame. But organizations like this, they inform the pastors on the right way of doing things and being legally correct. Because we are citizens of the land and we have to keep the law. Okay, so all these organizations are also there, Kennedy. So there is a voice, there are activists, there are people who are fighting for the right policy at the highest level. Okay, and I know of a very dear friend, a pastor of ours, I should say, of our APC team here, who is doing excellent work for pastors who are struggling at the grassroots levels. And in fact, he's done so much work that recently he decided that he will pursue LLB, which is a course in law also. So he's a pastor, but currently he's studying law to familiarize himself with the Indian constitution. So he's in a better position to help pastors. So in this way, there's a lot going on. There's a lot that is happening. Okay, great, great. So yeah, some good discussions there. So yeah, we come to an end of the class as well as the content in our notes here. So let's just wrap it up. We'll pray and we will close. If there are, you know, additional things that we want to discuss, we can always do that in the next class. So just like to request someone to lead close with a word of prayer, please. Then we can wrap it up. I'll just leave it open.
Can I pray?
Yes, yes, Shri Kumar.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you and honor you for this wonderful day. Father, we bless your holy name, O God, Master. Father, we pray that, Father God, every word what we learn today, O God, Master, let it deeply rooted in us. And Father God, let we walk in unity and let our focus should be on how to build the kingdom of Father God. We pray that, Father, pour out your love more and more in us. Let we not be discouraged because of the bitterness, because of jealousy, because of the things which is not happening the way how we are thinking, O God. Father, we pray that, Father, we need the Holy Spirit more and more so that we can be encouraged, so that we can prepare ourselves. The body of Christ can be strengthened by the power of God. Thank you for using your servant of God, Father God. Bless her and Father God, strengthen her. Thank you, Father God, preparing each one of our heart, Lord Master. And we believe that, Father, whatever we learn today, O God, let we be able to utilize it so that, Father, we can be united together. And Lord Master, we can be useful vessels for the kingdom of God. Thank you once again for answering our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you for the prayer, Shri Kumar. If I could just add something, I think I'll just switch off the record. And...